Hey folks, it's Frithgar here, how you doing? So I'm just bringing the Lindner down here to spray field one down here. Now, someone did suggest that these dual wheels would actually class as narrow tyres because they appear to be quite narrow. So I've just driven around a bit on the grass here and it doesn't appear to be. They do appear to be just standard. So I don't think we're going to be able to do much spraying. Although to be honest, especially with this field, I don't really have any inclination to do very much in the way of spraying once we've done one layer across the field. We may figure something else out. We may do a bit of weeding or something like that if we get a weeder going on there somewhere, but I probably won't worry about doing any more here to field one at least. So let's just get this underway. And oh, I just got to stop a second and go through here, change that to kilometers. And now we can carry on. Right. My question for this week. I am going to be buying sheep first. Before I get cattle, I will be getting sheep. And what I'd like to know is, how many sheep would you like me to get before I start getting cattle? I'm not asking you for the total number of sheep that you want me to get. I'm asking you how many you think I should get before I start working on cattle. Now, quite a few people have pointed out that if you go for the maximum number, it could be quite some time before we're able to actually start working on cattle on this map, and there could be several people that don't like that. But on the other side of the argument, quite a lot of people are saying they want me to get a lot of sheep to start off with because this is New Zealand, and New Zealand and sheep go hand in hand. And not only that, I haven't really done much in the way of sheep on any of the other maps. We've done it a little bit, but we haven't done it on any kind of scale. So it could be quite interesting to get that bit going first and then come back to the cattle later on. I haven't really done cattle on any kind of large scale either. I've mostly been concentrating on pigs on most of the maps. So yes, we're sort of expanding out and we're doing things a little bit differently. I am not going to spend this entire episode spraying. I'm going to just sort of start off now. We'll do the spraying while I chat. There's a couple of things I wanted to do. So what I might actually do is we might just get to the top here and then we can run over to the sheds over there. And there's a few other things that I want to do as well. And I'll come back and I'll finish doing the spraying on this map later on, in between now and next week. So we've got these two fields done and sprayed. We've got a combine sitting over in the shed, a New Holland combine. We're going to be selling that one along with the header, and we're going to be buying a new combine. Now, I've had quite a few suggestions. Some people are asking me to go for one of the Fendt combines, the modded ones. A few people are saying that Case is particularly popular in New Zealand. You get a lot of Case axial flow combines in New Zealand. And I've also had a lot of people asking for class Lexion or class of some sort, and saying that a class combine would actually be more fitting for this map than any other. So let me just stop right there a second. I'm going to stop this one here and we'll nip down there. There's something we need to see. Okay. Hang on. I need to unhitch that one. So I finished doing the seed drilling. That's all finished. And I don't think there was any other options for the blue on this vent. I think this was the only shade of blue. Now, someone has pointed out to me that I didn't need to go and buy that workshop up there. Glenn Koopman tells me that this here is a workshop. So, just come over and you just click the door to open it. We've got in here, it's a workshop. We've got the thingy right there. So, there's fertilizer in here. Okay, so we got a thing of fertilizer in here. But, most crucially, we didn't need to go and buy that one. So we might sell that one in a minute. A lot of people... So thank you very much, Glenn Koopman, for pointing that out. I'm kind of embarrassed now, to say the least. Let's just lift the door up on there. I'm going to leave the doors open on the workshop. Most places that I've worked that have had a specific workshop generally leave them open all the time. Some of them will shut them at night. So let's customize this one. The main color, so that's the only blue that we can get. It's just that blue there. So let's just go back. Now, rims. I've been told that if you blue tractor, I must have gray rims. A lot of people have been saying, what are you doing with the red rims? It's got to be grey rims so that it is realistic. So we'll do that. Now, crawler tracks we don't want. Twin wheels we don't want. Although, I'll tell you what. 20,000? Okay, we're not going to do that just now. 6,000 for twin wheels. Rear wheel dual is 4,000. Wide tyre with weight. Wide tyres, wheel weights. Now, I'm actually thinking that we get wheel weights and we don't, and then we won't have to worry about getting a front weight for a little while. But I'm actually also thinking that wide tyres would probably be better. So if, let's go for wide tyres and we'll do the rim colour. So customise there. That's 5,800. Okay. And come back. And so, yeah, we've got a great big weight on the back wheel. The front wheel already has a weight on there. That was already on there, I think. And it looks like we got the wide tyres. So, does that... That was the other thing I wanted to see, was customise. Wide tyre with weight. Is it the front wheel or is it the back wheel? Base price. That's the problem with this one. Look, see, we're being charged $1,000 each time. Even no matter what we change, you got the base total price $1,000. So why is it? Yeah. So we're being charged $1,000 each time we use this workshop. Whereas if we go and use the workshop up the top, I don't think we get charged at all. That's not so good. I'm not so pleased about that. I do think that we will actually keep our workshop up here. Because if you come up to this one up here, now, we've got things I need to get on with today, but this one here, the whole idea of buying the workshop and placing it on your farm is you don't get charged that initial $1,000. So you can't sell here, you can only customise. Wide tyre with weight, wide tyres, wheel weights. So let's just see what the wheel weights do. Customise. Now, that's zero, that's free. Okay, let's go back. Right, so the weights stay the same, and if you go to standard tyres on this one, I think the front weights stay the same. So, customise and wheel weight standard, customise, yes, okay. And there, you still got the weight on the front, but you don't have the weight on the back. So what's the weight on the back tyre for? I could understand it being useful for, like a front loader or something like that, or if you've got a heavy weight on the front. But what would be the advantage of using the front, the wide tyre with the weight? What would be the advantage of using this setup? Someone please let me know, because I don't have any experience with using these weights on the wheels. I've never driven a tractor that has used those. There's always been a front weight. I was also telling you last week about... Oh, I'll tell you what, there's one thing, other thing I wanted to do. I was telling you last week about my experience with the sprayers. It wasn't me that was doing it. It was the person that used to do the spraying on the farm that I worked on that did a huge amount of spraying. And they used to use the drip system and leave little dollops of foam all over the place was the one that I was looking at. Right, we want to customize that. And the color's got to be that one. It's a shade lighter. We'll stick with the white rims on this one. So customize that. Yes, okay. Threw it around a bit. So that is a much better shade. That's closer to the New Holland blue. So yeah, and a lot of people told me, well, actually these days, Frith, we don't use the droplet system any longer. We just use the GPS system. And that's a fair point, actually. I completely forgot about the GPS system. I've never used a GPS system in real life. It wasn't something that was commonly used back when I was regularly working on farms. It's been more than a decade since I was regularly working on farms. I've done a little few odd jobs every now and then, but that's about it. So really, my experience of farming is a lot different to how it is now. There's some things that are quite a bit different now to what they used to be. I'm going to get up to the dealership because there's quite a few things I'd like to buy today. Before I start buying animals. But one last thing, I said the other day that yes, we are now back driving on the right side of the road, on the left. It seems that one or two people have been a little bit upset by this comment because I said that my way was right and their way was wrong or something. I wasn't saying your way was wrong. I'm saying that I grew up driving on the left-hand side of the road. So for me, this feels correct. Beyond that, I've made no statement. I've not said anyone is better than anyone else. So yeah, that's all we have to say about that. For me, this is the right side of the road. But anyway, we got a lot of stuff that we need to buy today, so let's get up to the dealership and sort that out. And yes, I was just driving down the road without my beacons on, so I apologise for that. I shouldn't have been doing that. I should have had my beacons on. So let's just turn the tractor off there. So yes, if anybody could let me know, what is the advantage of... I can understand the advantage of having the wide tyres. You're reducing compaction with that. That's a big advantage. Wide tyres are very popular. We used to run a special type of tyre called a half flat, and basically you had very low air pressure and the tyre would be a lot wider on the bottom. It would spread right out. They do a similar system when driving 4x4 vehicles on very icy surfaces. It's quite common to let a lot of the air out and so spread the tyre out. We had special tyres that were designed for running like that, so that we didn't need special wide tyres or duals or anything like that. So I can understand that, but what is the advantage of this weight? I can't quite understand why you'd want this weight on the back. On the front, I could understand that would sort of be similar to having a weight on the front of the tractor. But the back tyres, I need a little help on this one. If anybody can let me know what is a, you know, a strong advantage of having that massive weight there, I would love to know. I would guess it's kind of added stability, maybe increased traction on steep ground or something like that. If you've got steep ground, you've got a load of weight further down, would that increase traction, I would guess. Or slippery surfaces, something like that. I'm not quite sure. But yeah, so I would love to know about that. Let me know. Now, we need to go here. So, I'm going to be buying a combine, and I'm actually going to save some money, and we're going to look for a class combine. A lot of people have said class, and if we can't get a class combine, we're going to go for a case. We're not going to go for the Fendt or those. We're actually going to go for well, I don't know, that one seems a bit big. For the fields that we've got, it's a bit big, so we might actually go for the same one that we've got on Goldcrest. I have been told categorically that you do not get Rotzel Mash in New Zealand. Several people from New Zealand have never heard of Rotzel Mash at all anywhere in the country, so we'll avoid the Rotzel Mash. Now what we want is mowers. We want a set of mowers, and I was thinking of getting those two, but quite frankly we want the ones that will work with the reverse drive, so we're going to get that one there. We're going to buy that one, yes. And we're also going to get that one. We're going to buy that one, yes. Now, we need a rake. So I'm going to buy a whole load of stuff now. Now, I was thinking, which of these could we get? We got the Kuhn Merge, which I think would be quite an interesting one to use. That's a 9.1 meter. That's 9.3 there. That mod there is 8 meters. We got the Rock one there. It's 8.9. I was wondering about the Merge. It's a very expensive one. And I'm actually thinking that we may do that at a later date, but I don't think we will today. I'd like to use this one because I'd like to use it in conjunction with the three mowers. So we'll go for that one today. Quite a bit cheaper. And also it means that we'll be able to buy more sheep early on if we do try to save our money a little bit. We're going to need a tedder. Now for tedders, I've got this new mod here, this Krone one. I've been told that Krone is exceptionally popular in New Zealand. That's only 6 metres wide, though. Oh, no, it's 11 metres. 11 metres isn't too bad. That one's 13. That one's 12.5, the Lely. We've used the Lely. The Pottinger I've not used in this series. I don't think I've used that one at all yet. I'm not sure. But it's the Krone here. So we're going to go for this one. This is a new mod that's not long out. Select that one, and I can't remember who made it. I did have that somewhere. But anyway, we've got that one. That's 23,000. Got quite a few options on it, that one. You can sort of make various adjustments on it. We've got a sprayer, so we're not going to worry about that for a minute. We're going to get a weeder. We're not going to get the one with the sewing tank. There's no other options here, so we're going to go for that one there. Buy. I'm not sure that one's really worth buying, but we're going to go for it anyway. The forage harvester, now I've been thinking about this most carefully. I will probably go for the New Holland one, although I've been told that Krone is exceptionally popular. Thank you very much for everybody in the comment section that's told me what the different things were. You've got the crawler track there, then you've got this Zwillingsbreifung. I'm not going to try to pronounce this because it is in German. I've been told it's in German, but I don't know what it is. Dual wheels for that one. I think that is wide tyres. Potentially, I'm not entirely certain. It was, someone did tell me what it was. You got wheel weights, you got wide tires, and I've had a, well, actually a few people have told me what they are. So thank you very much for everybody that responded on that. It was brilliant. I do have a reference I can look at. But any foraging we do, we're going to lease that to simulate calling in a contractor from outside, because that is what you would do in New Zealand. It is very uncommon for a farmer to own their own forage harvester, much like it is here in the UK for me. It's not something you would see on a regular basis. So we've got the mower, the tedder, the rake. Now we need to get the baler. Now I did promise you that we would get the coon one because we didn't use it for very much, so we're going for the coon one. And I did wonder about getting that one, but we're not going to. We're going to go for this one right here. We're going to buy that for $105,000. Okay, and we also need to get the artisan. We've got to buy that one for $70,000. And I also wanted to get the square bale wrapper. It would be pretty cool to do. I do quite a bit of that on the time lapse series. So we won't do a huge amount of square bale wrapping, but we will do a little bit. So we're going to... Actually, I'll tell you what. We might just lease the square bale wrapper. If we want to do a session of square bale wraps, we'll just lease it. And there is... I've got various mods here in the bale section now. I'm going to be trying out that quadro, but I'm not going to buy that one again. That would be another leased one. So we got the baler, we got the artisan, we've got various other bits and pieces. I'm just wondering what else we need to get. A telehandler might be good, although to start with, I think we will use the Lindner. We'll get that one adjusted so that it can take a front loader. Because of the rear wheel steer, it's going to be a lot more similar to a telehandler. It's just not going to have an extending boom. And we can come back to getting a telehandler at a later date. I'm deliberately avoiding getting a Kramer this time around because we got a Kramer last time. So we won't be using a Kramer this time. We'll be using a regular front loader to start with, and then we'll move to something else. And then in animals, we want an animal trailer. But again, these are quite expensive, so it might be better if we just lease one and then come back and get it at a later date. I don't think we will get anything for animals at the moment. So we're down to $650,000, and we're going to be getting a combine. At the moment, we don't have the modded combine that I would like, but I'm guessing it's going to be around $300,000 in order to get the combine and to get the header, maybe a bit more than that. So that is going to leave us with potentially $300,000. $300,000 for... we will then spend any money that we've got left, we're going to spend it on the sheep. And so we're looking at quite a bit of money being spent on sheep. Now we have got the all of these lined up here. Today we're not doing hay, we're just going to do some grass cutting and then row it up. And it's either going to be something that we're going to put straight in for the sheep. I've got to come round this way. Now which way do I want to do this? So it's got to go... Got to go this way, actually. I want to come onto this way. I'm having to drive into the hedge to do this, which is not ideal, but that's what we're going to do. So I'll pick that one up there. Now, I've been told by a few people that they've seen this in different places. One person told me that they've seen this in New Zealand a couple times. My Impospers, a longtime fan from the Netherlands, has said that she's seen this several times in the Netherlands. One of their neighbors actually has this set up and does this exact same thing. I've been told by several people I should put this on the front and then put the rake on the back. You can't actually do that because the sheer weight on the front linkage would cause a major issue. However, several people have told me that they have seen it on being done like this. So if we just... nope, I don't want to do that. I want to go there. Now, if I turn that one round... Oh, wow. It doesn't do that with the standard one. This is a modded one, so it doesn't actually swing you round like that when you change it about. But there we go. So that one has now flipped around so that we've got the mowers on the front and we've got the rake on the back, even though it's the opposite way around. Technically, you're not allowed to drive on the road like this, so we'll put hazard lights on. It's not something you would normally need in New Zealand, I've been told, but we have the hazard lights on now. It'll sort of alert people to our presence on the road. So we need to go to the sheep. Now, we're heading up this way, so the sheep are on the right-hand side, and I was thinking we'll do a couple of fields up round there. We'll do field 14, I should think. Maybe field 13, this one down here close to the road, but I was wondering about field 12, because it looks different. something about field 12 that looks a little different to the others. Might just be the texture on the map there. It may be like a detail that wasn't altered early on when it was supposed to have been, or something like that. I'm not quite sure. So it's just coming up here. And I think this is going to be fun, although I have spent most of the time talking, so we haven't actually done very much. There's our home over there. It's the homestead over there. It's right up on the hill. So actually, do we want to come in and do field 12? It's quite a big field. Let's start off with our initial plan of doing field 14, which is here on the right-hand side. The sheep up here, where's the actual sheep pen? That's the first part that we need to find out. I think the sheep pen, you've got field 9, which is that great long one down there, and then the sheep are... maybe the sheep are in field 17. I think the sheep are here in what is field 17. I think they're in this bit. You've got a section there. I think that in front of the building there is where we would unload the sheep. I'm not quite sure. So let's just spin round. We'll have to drive right round the troughs now. Come through like this. This is quite some setup that we've got. Probably a lot of farmers wouldn't have a setup quite this drastic. I want to go that way. And click on the gate that opens. Now, we're not actually need to worry about closing this gate. And I'm thinking that if we open that one as well, we could do these two fields together. And then we've got a load of grass for the sheep. And any grass that we don't use for the first sheep that we buy. Look at the narrow gateways. This is awesome. You're not going to get through there with machinery that's too big, are you? So we want to go to that one there. And I want to unfold that one and unfold. Go back through to that one. Start it up. Like that. And again, start up. Then go back through. Now, if you've got it just on the front one, if you look down in the bottom left-hand corner, bottom right-hand corner, sorry, I've got the double mowers highlighted. If you have the double mowers highlighted and then just press V, it actually lowers all three of them together, which is pretty cool. It doesn't do that with the starting and stopping of them, but it does do it with just raising and lowering. Now, the idea is we go to the rake on the back and we unfold that one, and then we put that one going, and it's roughly the same width as the mowers. So we end up with a single width because these mowers don't have any kind of swathing ability. Because they don't have any kind of swathing on them, it means that we do need to kind of use this setup. And I was surprised actually that this setup is used in different places around the world, purely because I was expecting to hear that, you know, most people would have mowers with swathers on them. But apparently the mowers with the swathers on them are not as common as I personally would have thought. So there we go. So that is our setup. We've got the mowers and the Fendt with the proper grey wheels this time. I'm using the wheel weights, although I'm still not quite certain what they're for. It might just be the hills. That's going to be my assumption until I'm told otherwise, is to help with stability on hills. I really, really do want to know about that one. That's one that I'm burning curiosity on. This one is, what exactly is it for? There must be a reason for having these great big weights. There wouldn't be an option on so many vehicles. And I can't for the life of me think what they are, because I've never driven a tractor that is specifically installed extra weights on the back wheels. I'm assuming that this practice has been around for quite some time. I'm not about to suggest that it's something that's entirely new. It's just new to me. So yeah, please fill me in on this one. I quite like this setup. It does work fairly well. We're getting a nice swath coming through with the mowers, and I also really like the fact that you can turn quite sharp with this. Because if you've got the mower on the front and the two mowers on the back, when you turn sharp, you leave stripes of grass, but it doesn't seem to happen with this. So that's actually really cool. I really like that. Come on through here. It's going to be a bit more interesting in a minute, because I've got to lift and drop absolutely everything in order to be able to keep it neat and tidy. Now, I'm going to go to the front mowers, and I'm going to hope that when I lift... I need to lift that, it lifts the mowers up, but now of course I need to lift the rake up. So what do I control and then lift? Is that going to lift everything? It is. Control and lift will lift absolutely everything up. Ooh, okay, this is going to be really difficult because it's on the front. The steering works quite a bit differently to normal, so it's quite difficult for doing the turn. That little turn there is not easy at all. So what I think we'll do is we'll drop them all down all at once, and then yeah, there we go. It's actually come out quite neatly and tidily there. I'm quite impressed. Okay, so you've got reasonable maneuverability with this. It's not the it's not the easiest system to sort of move around in the fields, but it's definitely good. It's definitely got some points there as far as I'm concerned. I suppose if we were using the Kuhn merger with this instead of this one here, it would make an even bigger difference, because we'd be able to put one row into another and do that a couple times around the field. There'd be quite a few different options that you'd be able to change on that, actually, because you can change the direction of flow on the merger, which again would make a significant difference to performance of the machine and everything. Just bring this one on round. So we're running out of time. I'm going to do a bit more of this in our next episode, and then we're going to get we're going to be getting sheep. In our very next episode, we're going to be getting sheep, and we're going to be finding out how many we're going to be getting. So now this time what I've got to do is I've got to lower the mowers here, and then I want to come forward a bit more, and then I want to lower those two on the back. There we go. That seems to work. So yes, my question for this week is, how many sheep do you want me to get before I start getting cattle? I'm not asking you for the total number of sheep we're going to end up with on this map. I'm asking you how many sheep you would like me to get before I start working on any cattle whatsoever. So do you want me to get 100, 200, 300, 400, or 500 sheep? It's your vote. It's your game. Head into the comment section down below. Let us know what you want and why. And of course, don't forget to actually cast your vote by mousing over in the top right-hand corner. And I've got a feeling I didn't actually ask you the question at the beginning of the episode. I think I started to ask you the question, and then I got sidetracked. So I got sidetracked for the entire episode this time, it would appear. So yeah, if I didn't actually ask you, I apologise. I should have done, and we'll get back to it. Well, we've gotten to it now, so we have eventually asked the question, even if I did forget right at the beginning. So just come on up a little bit further, and then press Control V so that it brings everything down. I'm starting to get the hang of these controls, and I've got to say, I do approve. I quite like it. I also like the grass and the cut grass texture, but I don't. The actual swath itself with the green is still quite difficult to make out. I know it's never easy to see that in real life either, but it isn't. Especially when it's sort of spread out on the ground, it does seem to make it quite difficult to see what you're doing. So if I go back that way, that will turn the wheels the other way. Then I got to turn fairly quickly in order to correct it. It's very difficult to get the steering just right when you've got it this way round. We'll come on up through, and I'll do one more pass, and then I will say fairly well. I will finish doing this field, and we will take a look at doing another field in our next episode. And then we've got to get the sheep, and then once we've got the sheep, we can then see about gathering up the grass and feeding them, and then any that's left over, I think we might even just sell a few bales of silage. I'm not quite sure, because we don't want to store bales of grass. There's one thing I don't want to do, is store bales of grass. Ooh, I know what we could do. We could always just turn it into hay, and then we've got our supply of food for the sheep early on, and it's sort of all done and dusted. We don't need to worry about it after today. That might actually be a very good thing to do. But anyway, I'll finish this field off. If you've enjoyed this episode, then please head down below and give us a like. And if you really enjoyed it, then please tell your friends all about me. Get them to watch as well. That would be awesome. But until next time, thank you very much for watching. This is Frithgar. Goodbye, and see you later.